to building single page applications with ASP.NET Core 2.0. My name is Jason Taylor and I'm a solution architect for SSW Brisbane. You can find me on Twitter at JasonGTAU or on my blog codingflow.net. I've been developing software now for over 17 years and I've found the most important principle to be KISS, or keep it simple, stupid. And this principle states that systems should be kept simple rather than more complicated. I use this principle to drive all of my development efforts in that I always seek to find the simplest solution to any given problem. And tonight, I'm going to show you the simplest approach to building single-page applications with ASP.NET Core. So I've got three topics that I'll cover. First is we'll create a single-page application, and I'll show you how easy it is to get up and running using your favorite IDE or operating system. Then we'll do a little bit of working with data, just so that you have the complete picture. I'll show you how you can create a database and manage your database using Entity Framework Core. And then we'll move on to building a web API. And I'll show you some tips and tricks for building a web API in ASP.NET Core. But most importantly, I'll show you how you can then document that API and generate your client-side code. So with those three pieces in place, you'll be able to build your single-page application and the database and document your client-side code so that you can be most productive and take the simplest approach possible. So let's have a talk about ASP.NET Core JavaScript services. This provides built-in support for single-page applications in ASP.NET Core, and it supports all major client-side frameworks, so Angular, Aurelia, React, pretty much everything. It's cross-platform, so you can develop on Windows, Mac, or Linux, and you can use your preferred IDE or code editor. Now, as a Windows developer tonight, I'll be using Notepad and the command prompt, but you can use whatever you want. I'm just kidding. So, you guys are so serious. I thought, now they believe me. They believe me. So, no, I'm going to use Visual Studio Code tonight because it's cross-platform. So, maybe you're using Visual Studio Code, maybe you're using something else, but at least you'll get a little bit of insight into something that'll work on any OS. So using Visual Studio 2017, if there are some people in the audience, I know that there's at least three, you'll just go File New Project, and you can actually select an Angular, React, or React and Redux application. If you're using the command prompt, then you can use the .NET Core CLI. All you need to do is install the .NET Core SDK, and you can simply run .NET new list to see the available templates, so you'll see that there's Angular, React, and React Plus Redux out of the box. And you can install some additional templates just by running this command. So I'm going to share a link to these slides and the source code at the end too, so you don't need to worry too much. So that leaves us with just one simple command if we want to create a single page app using ASP.NET Core. So that's .NET new Angular. So for Angular, .NET new Angular. But it wasn't always this simple. Well, I just want to share with you a blog post I wrote in May 2016. Now, I called it a quick start to building ASP.NET Core and Angular, but you'll see that was a lie. So if I scroll down a little bit, you actually need to follow this guide if you're just starting out. So to get started, the quick start, you first need to install Node, NPM, TypeScript, Git, Visual Studio Code, and you need to test your development environment. So it's quite extensive, especially if you're on a Windows machine, because everything's a little bit harder. So that's before you can do the quick start. And then once you get into the quick start, you need to scaffold a new application using Yarmin. And then you need to configure TypeScript. And then you need to configure and install your client dependencies. And then you need to configure ASP.NET Core. This is a quick start. And then you need to do all of these other things, but just don't fit into another category. And quick start. And then you're good. You're on an application. So my apologies. It's not a quick start, but it has gotten a lot easier. So now, for Aurelia, .NET new Aurelia. For Knockout, .NET new Knockout. For React, .NET new React. React and Redux. And Vue, .NET new Vue. Was anyone's framework not covered? Oh, that's amazing. I thought maybe this would be the group where someone finally puts up their hand and says, yeah, my framework wasn't covered. I'd be like sad, but I've been to Sydney, Canberra, Melbourne, and asked that same question and no one's put their hand up, so that's great. So let's have a look at creating a single page application with ASP.NET Core. So I have a bunch of demos tonight. It's pretty demo intensive. Let's jump into this first one. So as I said, I'm using Visual Studio Code. So if I jump into this directory, it's actually empty. So I've got a new project, and using Visual Studio Code, I can actually open a terminal window using Control Tilde. So if I press Control Tilde, I'm basically good to go. So as I promised, .NET New Angular. Now if you've just installed the .NET Core CLI, you might just want to run .NET by itself just to check that it's working, and you can check the version by running .NET version. So 2.02, so ASP.NET Core 2.0. So I might just zoom in a little bit actually, because I know sometimes it can be hard to read too much. We'll hide this. There we go. Let's have a look. Okay, .NET New Angular. Just like that. Okay, so you can see that it's gone ahead and created the app, and it's restoring the .NET Core packages, and then it'll say, hey, we need to do the npm install in just a moment. But on the side here, you can see it's created all of the files that you'll need to build the single page app. Now, I'm not going to run npm install because I'm on my 4G, and when you run npm install, it downloads the entire internet, including all of the lolcats. So I'm just going to switch over to one that I did earlier, and we'll have a look at that. Okay, so while this application loads, all I want to do now is run it. And to run this application, we can just go .NET run. It's pretty simple. Whoops, we've got to jump into the correct directory first. Now I'm going to do that about 7 more times tonight, and each time I'm not going to remember to jump into the correct directory, so just a warning. And .NET run. And what that is doing is it's actually starting up a little web server called Kestrel, which .NET Core web applications run on. And you can see that it starts up pretty quickly, and then we've got a link here that we can click on, and that'll take us to the application. Sometimes when I click on it, it doesn't do anything. There we go. I have to control click, I always forget. So this is what you get when you go .NET new. Depending on which framework you've chosen, what you'll see here will be slightly different. I've chosen Angular, so it's showing me what this template contains, which is ASP.NET Core, Angular and TypeScript for the client side code, Webpack and Bootstrap. And then it tells me about the features for this template, so client side navigation, server side programming, Webpack dev middleware, hot module replacement, and efficient production builds. So I modified this template a little bit just to make my presentation interesting. I disabled every one of those features so that we can have a look at them in turn and you can see what they bring to the table. So you can see here in the template, we've got a home page which tells us everything about this template. And then we've got a counter page, which is a simple Angular component. And then we have a fetch data page, which is a simple component which demonstrates fetching data from the server. So the template's quite simple, but it just does give you a good starting point. Now, in our actual code base here, see if we can minimize that. Now, it's got the client application code all in this client app folder. So we're using Angular, and so you can see the app and its components are all stored here. If we go down a little bit, probably don't need to do that. Can everyone up the back see that okay? Okay, great. So that's all our client-side code, and then we've got all our Angular code. So we've got some controllers. We've got our home controller, which is the entry point for our application. It basically just returns a view, which is where our client app kicks in. And then we have our sample data control, which is just a simple controller which returns the weather forecasts that we saw just here. And then we have all of our client-side files. So we've got our package.json that you'd expect to see, our ts.config, our webpack configuration, so that's for our files, and then our webpack configuration for all of our vendor files. But the important thing to remember is it's all ready to go. There's nothing that we really need to do to get started. So why don't we start by looking at the first feature. We've got client-side navigation, and what that basically means is it provides an optimized experience by integrating your server-side navigation with your client-side navigation experience. So if I open up the web developer toolbar, and we take a look at network, you can see when I'm switching between home and counter, it's not making a server-side request. And there's nothing exciting there. But if I actually make a server request to counter by just pressing enter on the address bar, it fails. And the reason is that I've turned off that integration. So let me show you how that works. So if we have a look at the startup.cs file, which is where everything happens in ASP.NET Core, we have what's called a SPAR fallback route. And this does one very simple thing. I'll just re-enable that. So the SPAR fallback route simply enables that smooth integration experience. So I just need to start up Kestrel again. And we'll see that that will be working. So while that's starting, I'll just explain this. So there's three things that happen when a request is made to Kestrel. The first thing is it says, am I a static file? And if it's a static file, it just returns that resource. So that could be an image or something. The second thing is does it match an MVC route? So the route might be home or home index or home index with an ID. If it matches one of those routes, then it will return it from there. Otherwise, if it doesn't match a server-side route, it'll just pass it back to the client application, Angular, and that client application can take over with its client-side routing and pick it up from there. So now that that's started, let's go back. We can see, okay, so that's working normally, but if I try to make a server-side request, so it actually makes that request, and what is the counter page? So it went to the server, couldn't find a matching route, said, okay, Angular, you take care of it, passed it back to Angular. Angular's like, yep, I know the counter route, and it loaded the page. So that's the smooth integration that you get. So the next feature that I want to show you is the server-side pre-rendering. And the best way to demonstrate that is to actually disable JavaScript. Because what server-side pre-rendering does is use Node.js on the server side to actually pre-render a version of your site and send that back to the client. And the benefit of that is that it enables a very quick response to the client, and that gives the user confidence that you've built a performant application and that they'll continue to use your application rather than go somewhere else. Now, it has two other features. The other is improved search engine optimization. There's some web crawlers which aren't able to crawl JavaScript, so you take care of that need. And there's also improved social media integration. So when you copy and paste a link to your site, say in Facebook Messenger, it'll be able to generate a preview of your site because JavaScript isn't required to do the rendering. So I've got JavaScript disabled now, and you can see that if I navigate between different areas of the site, it doesn't work at all. And that's pretty much to be expected because without JavaScript, the Angular application can't run. But if I enable server-side pre-rendering, which is just controlled through this default view, and you can see here, it's using an ASP.NET tag helper, ASP pre-render module, and it just points it at the server side, and that's what Node.js will compile. So with that enabled, just do a quick refresh. Okay, so now the application is working, even though JavaScript is disabled. However, you might be thinking, oh, that's great, now I can support users that don't have JavaScript enabled. But that's not the case. It's just the initial load that's really quick. You do need to re-enable JavaScript, and you do need to load the rest of the client in the background, because this isn't fully functional. So if I click on increment, you can see that Angular component isn't there. It's not actually working in the background. So it's just those three benefits that I mentioned, the best of which is that really fast initial load. Now I have to turn JavaScript back on, otherwise all my demos fail. Okay, so let's have a look at the next feature. And this is where it starts to get exciting for me. This is why I find this to be the simplest approach. We're going to have a look at Webpack Dev Middleware. So at the moment, if I want to change anything on this site, I actually have to stop Kestrel, run Webpack, and then start Kestrel again to see that change. And that's pretty painful. So let's go through that pain. So we'll change this to, I'll change my nav menu. We'll just go for something really simple. So currently, the title of the site just says Northwind. So I'm going to call it Northwind Spa. So if I save that, that's just a HTML page that I've changed. You know, you'd hope that I would just go refresh and I can see that change, but that's not the case because I need to run my client-side build processes. So if I kill Kestrel and then I go Webpack, it builds all of my client-side resources. And then I can start Kestrel again and we'll see that change. It's very painful. So when you look at the Webpack configuration for this site, there's two configurations. There's webpack.config.js and webpack.config.vendor.js. And what it's done is it's split the things that you write and the things that are third-party dependencies. And that means that when this server-side, when the Webpack Dev Middleware is running, it's only building and bundling the things that you've created, so that what it does is quite fast. Usually instant, but sometimes definitely less than a second. So there we go. So I've done that, and I've run Webpack, and I've started Kestrel up again. So if I refresh, I'll see the change to the title, which is Northwind Spa. So that's terrible. My apologies. So let's have a look at what this template does to actually make it better. So we enable Webpack Dev Middleware, and then we can start up Kestrel again. And now we can make changes to our site without actually having to restart Kestrel or run Webpack, because Webpack Dev Middleware will detect changes to your client-side files and run it for you so you don't have to worry about it. So let's have a look at that. So I'll do a quick refresh just to make sure everything's fine, and we'll go over and change something else now. I'll change my home component and I'll say, hello Brisbane. Just wait for that, that's good. Save the changes there, and if I do a quick refresh, we can see that that's changed over to Hello Brisbane. So that's good, that's much better, but it's still too painful for my needs. I don't want to refresh at all, I just want things to happen automatically. So the last feature that we're going to look at tonight for this template is hot module replacement. So if I go ahead and enable that, what it will do is actually continue to monitor my client-side files for any changes. It will continue to run Webpack in the background, but then it will inject those changes directly into the browser so I don't have to do anything. So that is starting. Let's find something to change. So I've got my nav menu and it's got some pretty cool styles. Let's see if we can make that a little bit better. I'll hide this over here. Okay, there we go, so we can see everything. Okay, so if I change this background color to some random color, like, I don't know, coffee, and this one to gray, and then more coffee, just can't get enough, and I just save that, that should come through automatically, fingers crossed. Let me just make sure everything's working. Console.
You should refresh the first
time. I should have refreshed. Thank you, Tiago. I'll undo that. I've undone those changes so we can see. So what we want to see in the console here is HMR connected. And if we see HMR connected, then we're good to go. So now I can redo my changes, save, and then you can see the bundle. and the bundle rebuilding, and then the instant update. So now any changes that I make, I don't have to worry about doing anything on my browser. I can put that on my second window, and I can see that change happening automatically. And that's a pretty nice experience, and that's the kind of the main things that I like about using this template. But then what about the server side? Do I get the same experience if I make a change to a server side file? Well, no, but there is something we can do to enable that experience, because who has time for that on the server side? So this is quite simple. All we have to do is add a package. So you can see I've opened up my Northwind Presentation CS project, and there's a .NET CLI tool reference called Microsoft.NET Watcher Tools, and it does pretty much what the Webpack Dev middleware does. It actually watches for changes to server-side files, and if there's a change, it restarts Kestrel for you, so you don't have to worry about it. So before we were going .NET run, this time we just have to go .NET watch run, and we'll get that experience on the server side. So while that starts, I'll just go ahead and load up the sample data controller so we can make a change. Okay, so that is running. Okay, good. So if we have a look at our fetch data, currently it's returning 5 items. We want it to return 10. So if I make this change and save, so you can see in the background it's actually said, oh, I've detected a change, and it's going to restart Kestrel without me having to do a quick build, restart Kestrel. It's not as fast as Webpack Dev middleware, but it's definitely faster than me doing it manually. So that's done. So now if I go back, that's changed, so I didn't have to actually do anything. So the cool thing is I can just keep developing. I don't really need to worry about my clients have resources, and I don't need to worry about their, my server-side resources. They're going to take care of themselves, so I just focus on development. So that's why I think this is the simplest approach to single page application development. So, next we'll have a look at working with data. So I want to give you guys a really quick introduction to Entity Framework, or at least show you where you can find some resources, and then a quick demo of using Entity Framework or through the command prompt. Now I have to apologize, this isn't the most exciting part of this presentation. Building a web API is definitely more interesting. So I'm going to move through it pretty quickly because I know you guys are interested more in the client side of things. So let's have a look. Entity Framework Core. It's lightweight, extensible, and cross-platform. So we use it with databases such as SQL Server, Postgres, MySQL. This provides for many, many different databases. And it's cross-platform, so you know it runs on Linux, Mac, and Windows. You can run it on .NET Core or .NET Framework. And if you're interested in working out whether you should be using EF6 or EF Core, you can have a look at that resource. There are some differences in feature set. If you're interested in upgrading from EF6 to EF Core, you can look at that resource. And if you're interested in the new features that are coming up, you can look at that resource. Let's jump to the demo. I just want to show you how we can actually work with it from the command prompt. So if we open my next demo, and if you have a look at the source code on GitHub, you'll see that I continue to build this app all the way through, and you can get the full source code at the end. So I have a simple domain, which is consists of everything you'd expect in Northwind. So we've got customers, orders, order details, and then over here I have a data project, and that's where the Northwind context is stored. Now, the context is basically the entry point for Entity Framework Core applications. So it orchestrates all behavior between Entity Framework and whatever database you happen to be using, whether it's MySQL or SQL Server. So I'm going to open a terminal, and we need to actually just run the .NET Core CLI to access our Entity Framework commands. If we run .NET EF, what we should expect to see is the magic unicorn. And if we see the magic unicorn, that means that everything's okay and we can start working with Entity Framework Core. Now, I just want to show you quickly what packages are required to work with Entity Framework Core. So there's just three. So there's whatever provider you're using. So this is SQL Server. You might be using Postgres. Then there's this design package and this CLI tool. So those three packages basically mean that we can see the Magic Unicorn. So there's only three commands in the EF Core CLI: this database, DB context, and migrations. So we're going to have a look at creating a migration. What migration allows you to do is to scaffold out your database so you can create it for multiple environments, and also allows you to manage the updates for your database as they are created. So let's create a migration. So if I go .NET EF migrations and add, and then I give my migration a name, and then I just need to specify the startup project. So my startup project is Northwind presentation, and that's what actually tells Entity Framework how it can access my database. So if we run that, you'll see on the side here, it's actually going to create a new migrations folder in this persistence layer. And the migrations folder will contain one migration, it'll be called initial create, and it will have all of the commands needed to create that database from scratch. So we can go to another server, point it at a new database, and create it very simply. Patient. A quick show of hands, how many people here are familiar with ASP.NET Core and Entity Framework Core? Okay, cool. So it's about 15% of the room. I've got some resources at the end which will show those other people who aren't familiar. So this is my migration, initial create. And if we just have a quick scroll through, you can see that it's creating tables. It's creating a table called categories, customers, employees, and that can be used to then scaffold a new database. So now I just want to run that migration. So that's pretty simple. I want to do that. So if I just clear this, and I'll just reuse my extra command, the command that I created before, because we want that same startup project switch. So if I just go EF database update, it'll actually then go ahead and create that database if it doesn't exist, or it'll throw me a mean error if it does exist. So while that's happening, let me see. I can show you some other things. So if you run .NET, oh no, I can't do that. Let's try again, .NET EF. Oh, that's right. This JS, I just .NET 2. If you run .NET EF, you can see the different commands that are available. And if you want to explore the .NET Core CLI at any point, just try the commands. So you can run .NET EF database, and you can see here that there's basically drop or update. So over here, we've just run the update command, and it's gone ahead and created the database. And then there's the migrations commands, EF migrations. So if you run that, you can see the options that are available. So we ran add migration, but there's also list to remove and script. Script is a really interesting one if you're in an environment where your DBAs don't give you access to the database server. It'll actually just generate a SQL script which you can give to them and then they can run. So you can use migrations whether you have access to the server or not. So that's pretty simple. So it's gone ahead and created a database. So you've seen how to create some migrations and then how to go ahead and create the database. Let's have a look now at building a web API. So I'm going to show you a couple of things in building a web API. I'm going to show you a typical example of a web API, and then I'm going to show you a better example of a web API. And then I'm going to show you something which I think is exciting, and that's using Swagger to generate a TypeScript client for your web API, which you can then use in your client-side application. So if we jump into this project, so this is our, I'll just hide all of this. So this is the typical controller. And it's a customer's controller. And you can see here, it's just a simple RESTful API. It's got a method, get customers, which returns a list of customers. And you can see here that it's asynchronous, and it's returning a status code of 200, but it's connecting directly to the database, which is probably a bit of an anti-pattern or a code smell. And it's also returning domain entities, which you really should avoid. And that's basically what you'll see when you first see people trying to create controllers in ASP.NET Core. Direct connections to the database, lots of business logic in here, lots of mapping logic which could be put elsewhere. So pretty typical. Let's have a look at a different one that I've built. So I've got a customer's controller. And what you'll notice straight away about this controller is there's no longer a dependency on entity framework. We're actually using command query resource separation to separate our queries from our commands. And when you look at the constructor for the customer's controller, you can see that it's actually very clear what this controller requires. There's nothing hidden there. And now our get customers command is no longer connecting directly to entity framework, and it's no longer returning entity models. We have view models that we're returning to the client side. And what you can see is that this controller has gotten a lot skinnier. It's a lot simpler than the controller I showed you before. Each line, each actual action has one or maximum two lines of code for the same functionality. So we did that by implementing CQRS, and also by implementing some little filters which are helpers. So this validate model attribute that you can see here on post customer, it basically validates that this create customer model has all of its, meets all of its requirements. So the customer ID is not greater than 5 characters, the address is not greater than 60 characters. So before, we actually had to have checks for that sort of thing. So we'd say, is model state valid? We'd say here, and here. But now, we actually just, now we just add that attribute where it's required. And before we needed to check to see if the customer existed in multiple places. Now we just have an attribute, validate customer exists. So this will actually return a 404 if the customer doesn't exist, and it'll do the same thing here. So we've removed all of that duplicated logic, and as a result, we've got a pretty awesome controller. It's as simple as it can be, it's easy to understand, and our logic has been encapsulated nicely either in a command or a query, and that's also very simple to understand and read, and very simple to reuse wherever we might need it in the application. So running, I'll just start this application. What I've got running behind the scenes is a tool called NSWAG. Just a show of hands, who's heard of NSWAG? Okay, no problem, so not too many people, about 10%. Well, who's heard of Swagger? Okay, pretty much everyone. So NSWAG is a tool chain for Swagger, and it supports generating clients across generating clients across a wide number of languages and client-side frameworks. So I'll just run this one. We can have a look at that. So to get NSWAG working in this application, I had to install a couple of packages. So the first package was, of course, NSWAG. So you can see I've got a reference there to NSWAG ASP.NET Core version 11. And then I just had to make some configuration in startup. So you can see here, I've got UseSwagger UI, and that allows me to do this when it works. Let's have a look. Okay, not quite there yet. Okay, almost. Ah, right. So I have this seed method in this project, and it seeds the Northwind database. It actually adds all of the customers and orders and records. And I'm particularly proud of this method, and probably not for reasons that you'd think. The reason that I'm proud of it is because it's 17,000 lines of code, and in some cases 40,000 characters long, because I've embedded images in there as well. So you get the full Northwind experience. So if I scroll across, there's one of the images. So you get the full Northwind experience, including the grainy bitmap images from the 90s. So if that's what you're looking for, you'll definitely find it in this code base. So there's Swagger UI running. We can see our customer's controller, and we can see that we can test out these different methods, which is cool. Swagger's cool. I think everyone here knows that. But what I really like to do is then to use NSwag, and in this case, I'm going to show you NSwag Studio to generate my client side. So if I go ahead and grab this Swagger specification or this OpenAPI specification, you can see that it's just plain JSON and JSON schema, and it describes the API that I've built. I can paste it in here, and then I can use this. Let me zoom in a little bit there. Then I can actually specify some outputs that I want. So I'd like to generate a TypeScript client for my server-side API. So I can then select TypeScript client, and I can configure various options. So I can select TypeScript version 2, the template I'd like to use. In this case, I want to generate an Angular service. Oops. Angular. And I'm going to leave those defaults alone. I like my services to be called service. So I'll go ahead and change that. And I like interfaces for my client classes, because it's actually going to not just generate services to access the RESTful API, it's also going to generate DTOs of my server-side view models so that I don't have to create them. So if I could generate outputs, it will run that against my Swagger specification and generate that full TypeScript client for accessing my customer service. So you can see here, get customers, post customer, get customer, pull customer, delete customer. And if I scroll down, I went all the way. We can see the DTOs that it's generated as well. So I don't have to do that now because it's done it for me. And not only that, I've got a single source of truth. My server-side API is the source of truth. And if I need to regenerate my client-side service, I can do that anytime. So one of the cool things about NSwag is I can actually then save this configuration that I've just built and actually save it as an nswag.json file. Now I won't do that because I've already done it here. If I scroll down, you can see the configuration and it's pointing at my API. And because that's there in the root of my project, as long as I've got my Kestrel server running, to regenerate my client, all I have to do is from nswag run, because I've got a package reference to the nswag CLI. So if I go ahead and run that, it'll create in my app, in a services folder, which doesn't exist currently, the TypeScript client for accessing my server-side API. So, oh yeah, so I have to jump into my presentation, of course. Just going to do it. I only did that twice tonight, which is pretty good. Okay, so if I run that, it's generating it, and my services should appear here. And then there's my client. So now I can integrate that into my build process and have that generate automatically, perhaps when the .NET build happens. And it's there, ready to go, and I don't have to do that anymore, which is cool, because that's a lot of code that's being generated, and it's good code. We use it in production for such a small API. All right, so that's everything that I wanted to show you tonight. I've just got a few resources to share with you. The first is this resource, Introduction to ASP.NET Core. So if you're not familiar with ASP.NET Core or Entity Framework Core and you'd like to learn more, this is the best place to start, and it's a great resource. There's lots of really good tutorials and guides that can help you on that journey. If you're interested in taking a look at the source code and the slide deck from tonight, you can jump over to this resource, which includes everything. And also, I'm from SSW, as you know. We're hiring at SSW. And if you'd like to work with a really great team, some of the best developers, there's three here tonight, there's also myself, come and see me. Google SSW Employment. We're definitely looking for more people. Thank you.